Hello everybody, welcome to this Canex Solutions webinar. The webinar is presented by Siemens, and before that, Canex will give a presentation on the dimming realization with the Canex and specifically with ETS. So before we go into the topics today, I want to give you the procedure of this webinar. So now you probably have noticed that everybody is muted, but you can talk to us and the presenters through the chat box. Somebody has been using it. That's great. And the questions and remarks you can type through chat boxes, but please remind it that the answers will only be given at the end of the presentation. So you can ask questions to Canex and to Siemens, but at the end of the presentation. Great. So let's now move on to the presentation by Canex, specifically my colleague Christoph Patuns, on Canex dimming basics and demonstration. Now let's welcome Chris.
Yes, thank you, Sarah. I hope that everybody can clearly hear me. So I have been asked to explain to you how to realize actually a dimming function or functions with KNX, and of course how to do this specifically with ETS. So therefore, I have prepared a little demonstration, actually. So I will just not use slides. I will just purely present it from ETS as an ETS user. So first of all, let's have a look at the actual installation here, which is actually not an installation. It's a virtual installation, so not physical. But of course, it behaves like a physical installation. So basically, what I have here is just an series of push buttons. So it's actually a virtualization or a simulation of a push button interface, with which I will try to control these lamps here, which are dimmable and which are connected, of course, to a dimmer. Again, everything virtual. Obviously. Okay, so then second, so if I now would manipulate these buttons here, as you can see for yourself, exactly nothing is happening here. Also, when I would start the monitor, right, connected to this installation, also you can see that manipulating these rockers here, these buttons, actually result in no action on the bus. Okay, so that's pretty normal because these devices are in, so to say, X factory state. Okay, let's try to make at least one lamp here work. Let's try to make it dimmable. So again, I've prepared also an ETS project that just contains, of course, these two devices, or that represent actually those two devices. And that is the dimmer and the push button. The dimmer has 8 channels and the push button as well. So what I will do now, I will just select channel 1 and channel 1 of the dimmer and channel 1 of the push button respectively. And this will give us then an overview of the objects, the communication objects that are available in these devices. So we can clearly see on the dimmer side, there's an on-off object, there's a dimmer control, there's also dimming value, and 2 info objects. Then for the push button, we see something similar, although it's a bit different because here I only see on-off and dimming control. And there's also a feedback object. So first of all, also please note, note that for a dimmer, I'll need indeed at least an on-off object. So that is indeed one bit information that will be exchanged. And I will also need, in order to dim it, I need a dimming control object, and this has a length of 4 bits. Now, so I see that on both the dimmer as on the push button. So here I have the similar or the same kind of objects. So 1 bit for on off and a 4 bit for dimming control. And there's also a feedback object. But I will just start with a very basic thing, and that is I'll first of all try to just switch on the lamp. Maybe that is a good way to explain it to you. So what I'll just do is I'll select both these on-off objects, so on both sides, so both on the dimmer as on the push button, and then I just link that with a group address that I already prepared also in advance. So for channel 1, on-off. Okay. Then I need to load this configuration, because this is a configuration change, obviously. I need to load that into the devices. I already loaded the individual addresses, so the 1.1 and the 1.1.2, respectively. So I don't need to do that again. So I just basically need to, for the dimmer, download its application. And then you can see in the monitor that indeed stuff has been loaded into the device. I do the same for the push button. So also here I do a download. I just clear the monitor because we don't need all these telegrams to see here. And if I now click on the channel 1 buttons here, I expect this lamp to be switched on. So let's try. And indeed, also on the monitor, we can see that there is now action on the bus. I can, of course, switch it off again. Of course, that is only half the exercise, or let's say only part of the exercise. I also need to be able to dim it, because if I try to do something with long pushes, so I exactly try right now, nothing happens, right? You see, nothing happens here. Okay, which is quite normal. So I'll continue with the exercise. I just do the same thing again. I just select both channels again. And of course, you can already guess what I'm going to do. I just select both dimming control objects and then link them with an existing group address. The channel 1 dimming control, yes, was already there. Fine. Sorry, that is a wrong operation. Also, again, this is a modification, so I need to load it. So I start with the dimmer, download. And then partial download. Push button, same thing. Partial download. And what we will see now is that I can switch on the lamp. So first of all, let me clear maybe the monitor again. And now I can dim it down, as you can see, dim it up. I hope that is also clear on your screen. You can definitely see the yellow becoming lighter or darker here. And of course, I can entirely switch it off again. Okay, before I really give the floor back to Sarah or to Mr. Grossman, I'll maybe do one more thing, right, to end this story. Maybe I show you also how the dimming value can be controlled. Obviously, not with the push button, but this could be done with the monitor. I show you, so I also make a link here. Let me check if this is the correct one. Channel 1 dimming value, yes, nice. I'll do a partial download again. I clear the monitor, and then let me try to do something with that group address. So I want to control this value. So I should select 113. So here from this list, I select 1013, sorry. And then I'll just write some value like 60% example given. And when I click now the write button, I expect indeed that the lamp one, channel one here, immediately switches to 60%. So let us try. And indeed, this is the case. So there is a value here. And of course, I could still dim up from here onwards and dim down, etc., etc. So this is actually a very basic configuration that I have shown to you. And this is actually, all I actually had to say about this. Of course, there are more advanced features like info on off and info dimming value. You can also play with the flags, etc. But this is beyond the scope of this webinar. I'll rather stop here and give the floor or the word back to Sarah. And for my point of view, or what I had to add is that the only thing I can say more is that I'm very happy that you were all here, and I'm very happy. I have to thank you for your attention. And if you have questions related to KNX in general, of course I'll be happy to answer them. As Sarah said, after Mr. Grossman has finished with his presentation. Again, thanks for your attention.
Great. Thank you very much, Chris, for the presentation. I hope the audience has now more and better knowledge about dimming with KNX. And the next topic is our presenter will be Mr. Axel Gottsman from Siemens, and specifically about the dimming in LED lamp retrofits, the issues, and the solutions.
Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. My topic today is dimming LED lamp retrofits, issues and solutions. At first, my introduction. You have heard my name already, Axel Grossman. I work for the Siemens company in Regensburg, which is in Germany. I'm working in the former EIB and nowadays KNX department since the year 1991. And I am responsible for all KNX training matters since the year 1999. Okay, let's get into the topic. Here is the overview of my presentation. At first, let me tell you a little bit about our motivation. Then the issues, of course, which are in the title mentioned. I will give you some good advices. As you can see, they are in parentheses, which means not really good advices. And afterwards, I will present you the perfect solution of our new universal dimmer. For decades, people have been using incandescent lamps. Later, halogen lamps were added. Both types could be perfectly dimmed by all kind of triac dimmers. It was only how many watts you wanted to dim. But nowadays, due to energy saving laws, these lamp types are not permitted to be sold anymore, at least in our countries, in the European Union. And I have heard it also in other countries and continents in the world. So they must be replaced by energy saving lamps, which are nowadays based all on LED technology. Since the first invention of such LED lamps, it has been a real challenge to get them dimmed as good as incandescent lamps. In most cases, the user lost the battle so far. So it was our goal at Siemens in Regensburg to develop the perfect solution which can dim all types of lamps, with a slight exception, fluorescent tubes and high-pressure gas discharge lamps will also not be dimmable with our new dimmer. Let's talk about all these issues, which are currently encountered by the users. LED lamps have drivers which have their own regulation. So this is much different to incandescent lamps. So there can be conflicts with the dimmer, because the dimmer does the same. It also wants to regulate something. And you know what happens if you have two regulations which do not match each other. LED lamps can have different circuits. We don't know them. They have some semiconductor chips which drive LEDs in parallel, which have serial LED control, current voltage control, a matrix of LEDs you can have in lamps. Filament LED strips are on the market, and all of them show a very different dimming behavior. And most of all, LEDs are originally not dimmable at all, not like incandescent lamps. LED drivers can cause high inrush currents every 10 milliseconds at every zero crossing of mains voltage. This can lead to tripping of MCBs, even if their rated current is not reached by far, and also to the shutting down of dimmers. LED drivers may react very sensibly on grid interferences, for example, ripple control signals or frequency inverters for motor controllers of elevators. If the lamp and the dimmer are not matching, lamps may flicker or even oscillate on and off periodically. Even if you find a combination where dimming works smoothly, there might be not enough dynamic, which is the ratio between the maximum and the minimum dimming value. Low loads of LEDs cannot be turned off due to the interference suppressor capacitors of legacy dimmers. Not matching material can even destroy each other. There are a lot of people who want to use the same fixtures they had with legacy lamps before, only with a new LED lamp. They just replace old by new. But the new energy-saving lamp does not operate with the old dimmer anymore. Fixtures, in comparison with integrated LEDs, that means the complete solution, are very expensive. And if only one LED fails on such a fixture, normally you must replace the whole part. It is not possible to have an individual replacement of lamps. So therefore, many customers want to have their normal retrofit lamps back. Automatic dimmers often cannot find the correct dimming mode. No channel bundling at higher loads than one channel supports possible. Legacy dimmers could dim LEDs sometimes, but at a very low power setting ratio only, usually 20% of the maximum power for incandescent lamps. Manual operation override of dimmers in distribution boards is limited or not available. So, what should be done to overcome all these problems, all these issues? Well, there is one advice: use only recommended LED lamps with a certain dimmer. Well, what is the answer to this advice? There are 10,000 of different makes on the market now. Many of them you can just order on the internet, and they all come from Asia, I guess. And the electronic of recommended lamps even might change without notice by the manufacturer. So then you use a recommended lamp with a recommended dimmer and it still doesn't match anymore. So this is not a good advice. Sometimes you are said replace all components so that you have the matching devices and lamps. Well, we can do this, but who can afford always to invest such sums of money every few years when the material has changed, when the lamps have to be replaced, new dimmers all the time? That's not a solution, I guess. You can also try to change the parameters of the dimmer, if there are parameters, until you find a suitable configuration. Well, who has the time for this? Doing all these experiments on the building site? Do you have the time? And what means suitable? What is a suitable configuration? Okay, use a digitally controlled dimmer and lamp system via power line. Like some well-known manufacturers of lamps have developed some years ago. Well, I have seen this on the fair Lighten building 2 years ago. But so far, I can't see such dimmers and lamps anywhere on the market. And even if they were available, this is following my second argument above. Replace all components. It's too expensive. Another very, very good advice is very often just use a parallel resistor or a hidden incandescent lamp somewhere in the distribution board. This will avoid switching off problems. You can switch off LEDs. But I think LEDs should save energy. Another good advice is, why do you use dimmable lamps anyway? You can return to switching function only, because the low energy consumption is already given even with full brightness. Well, I want my comfort like in old times. You can also hear the advice, use DALI. Here the ballasts and the lamps are perfectly matching. Well, in certain premises this might work, but I don't need another bus, up to 64 fixtures, a gateway to DALI, etc. This is too expensive, and there are no standard ballasts for retrofits. So, what are actually the features a perfect solution to the before mentioned issues must provide? Let's first have a look at the mechanical panel of the device. What must it have? This is the overrides and the diagnostics. We have, in comparison to legacy dimmers, a lot of information on the front panel. We must have indications for, especially for diagnostics. That means, is there a short circuit? Is there overload? Is there overtemperature? Do we have a channel failure? Very often in the past, service people went to the distribution board and did not know anything about what has happened if a dimmer has failed. Manual override, manual control is perfectly available. So each channel individually or combined. So here we have the circuit of such a four-channel dimmer. And you can individually operate all channels, of course, just pressing a certain button sequence on the front panel here. And you can also use channel bundling. And you can do this already ex-factory. That means on delivery, the device can be used with channel bundling. You can bundle two channels, AB or CD, more general or all adjacent channels can be bundled to form 1 times 500 watt output, instead of 2 times 200, 300. Or you can use 3 channels, or you can use 4 channels. So all of this is possible, and it can already be tested before the device is programmed by ETS. Once it is programmed by ETS, of course, it will follow the configuration of ETS. But of course, channel bundling is also possible with ETS. X-Factory settings should be able to be recovered with a certain procedure. In this case, it's pressing the program button of the device for at least 20 seconds. Functions. What must a modern universal dimmer support? You see a very, very comprehensive workflow here on the side of all the possible functions. At first, we have device wide functions, which are channel bundling, monitoring of the function, and that does not mean only the status of switching and value control. It means also the behavior of the dimming, the overload condition or the load condition in general, and if there are some failures, targeted reading status of status values must be possible, and the building side, which I mentioned already, the building side function switching. Then we have the functions per channel, and here we distinguish between the regular controls, the override controls. These override controls are within the ETS application, not the manual overrides I showed you before, and the diagnostic functions. You see this all here. It's a little bit small, of course, to see what it means. Let me go through them individually. Okay, we start with the control functions. You can see on the top, we send status value. Okay, this is just the status. When we go further down, we see that it's like, well, it's, what should I call it? It's a workflow which detects all the inputs which you can send to this device, to this application, and it will send the resulting value, which finally goes to the output in the end, through a couple of operating circuits, of course, software operating circuits. So, for example, you have the option for normal operation and time switch mode. You can also turn the device into flashing mode. This is the general setting. And then following the presets, you have logic operation as well. Logic operation was not possible with dimmers before, but very often it was required. So this time, a dimmer should have also logic operations like any switching actuator had 20 years ago. Central switching should be possible. Scene control, of course, should be possible, integrated. Another nice feature is set dimming values with two different objects. Two different objects means we have a fast ramp for manual control, and we can use a slow ramp for automatic control, like constant light level control, where smooth dimming is normally required. Okay, the timers for night and day mode operation are very abundant. You can use a lot of different features with that, which I do not want to explain in detail at the moment. Timed operation for staircase lighting, for example, also can be used with the post-triggering option. Post-triggering means if you have set up, for example, a time of 3 minutes to switch off, if you trigger the button up to five times, this will add up to the time up to 15 minutes, for example. You have variable on and off delay times. Okay. You have also options for bus voltage failure. Okay. But this is nothing very special. Let's have a look at something more special, the overrides. A dimmer should have also the option to be directly controlled by certain locking functions or direct control functions over the bus, which override the normal manual control function. So we have up to 7 blocks of overrides, which could be arranged in series. And so here you see the choice, fixed on, manual on, or permanent off, for example, or it simply can be blocked from operation. It's like a gate function. Central override is possible, and you can have also a user-defined override function, which you can set up like one of these before or completely different. And the force control is possible. We can also limit the maximum dimming value. And again, the control value input, what does it actually mean? A control value input instead of a switching input. You can use any analog values out of 8-bit, 16-bit, or 32-bit and define thresholds for the dimmer to be turned on and off. And you can also use a target value control so that it is not turned off to the maximum, but to a certain value, together with all the other inputs. We have also status messages for the overrides. Now, the diagnostics. Diagnostic functions refer to what? They actually refer to all status messages, minimum and maximum dimming values can also be changed via objects. And this means, this is very comfortable for the user when he wants to replace the lamps later by different makes and with different dimming behavior. Usually, then the minimum and the maximum brightness values have to change. And he can do this via a visualization, for example. Operating modes of the automatic load detection can be requested via object. And so in this mode, you can see if the dimmer runs in trailing or in leading edge operation mode. And we will see later how we can overcome issues if the dimmer runs in leading edge mode. We have, of course, also the status indication of all kind of detected faults. And what is also very nice that we have it on such a dimmer, this is the keeping track of the operation hours and the switching cycles. For what is this useful? You can use lamps, nowadays LEDs, which offer 15,000, 20,000, 25,000 hours of lifetime. And they offer maybe 50,000 and 100,000 switching cycles. If you look at the low cost products, then they are already reduced to 10,000 hours and only 10,000 switching cycles. So you can monitor this, if this is true, if this really works. On the other hand, with these counters, you can also set alarms or warnings just before the expected lifetime is reached, these operation hours and the load cycles. So you can replace the lamps before they fail. And here is actually the highlight what such a perfect solution must have nowadays. It's the adjustable dimming curves. It should have a parameter that can be used to adjust the brightness control in relation to the dimming value to the behavior of a lamp. And we know there are different lamps on the market with totally different behavior. So we see here some curves. These curves should be over proportional, linear, and under proportional dimming versus the brightness, the output of the lamp here. Here is the output of the lamp, the brightness, and here you see the dimming value. Okay, these are built-in curves, presets, so there's nothing to be set. You just change to this curve and then you test it. If the test does not work properly, then you can turn to the user-defined curve. With this setting, user-defined dimming curve, it is possible to enter a set of values, of value pairs, up to 16 are possible. And here you can actually find out how the lamp behaves and how can you correct for this, let's say, faulty dimming behavior, how can you control against it. Here we have a comparison of light bulbs. This is incandescent light on the left side. And here we have an LED on the right side. We have tested for leading and for trailing edge operation. And you can see the different behavior. Yeah, this is for the incandescent lamp. This is logarithmic. And for the human eye, it is almost linear. And we know this from incandescent lights. But how does the LED lamp react? You can see the output is linear. It starts at 15% dimming value. Below it is zero. So it switches on at 15%. And it is already finished at 90% in case of trailing edge operation. In case of leading edge, the whole curve is a little bit misshaped and shifted to the right. And it switches on only at 30%. So this must lead to corrections, of course, because this is not a good dynamic. It's not a good behavior. So you must set up certain value configurations. Later, I tell you what has to be done here. At first, let me have also a look at the different types of LED lamps. What is an LED retrofit? Well, most of you will remember it's an Edison 27, Edison 14 socket, or it's also GU10 or G9 socket, all for 230 volt operation or 120 volt whatsoever. In many cases, the LEDs are not set to be dimmable. You can also have low voltage. You can also have 12 volt LED with special drivers, mostly electronic transformers. And then the question always is, which LEDs are dimmable? Let me tell you one experience I have made on the internet. When you want to search for dimmable LEDs on the internet, what do you do on Google, for example? You enter dimmable LED. What do you get? You get all LEDs, because in the search of Google, not dimmable is also matching with dimmable. It's just ignored. So you get all of them. So how can you search for dimmable LEDs on the internet? I have not found a solution. Perhaps somebody can tell me how I would find this out. The only solution is you have to closely investigate if this product that you have selected is really dimmable. This is the first thing what you have to look for. If it is not dimmable at all, it makes no sense to buy it for a dimmer. But even if it is dimmable, marked as dimmable by the manufacturer, it still does not guarantee dimming at all. You must have the matching dimmer. Let's finally look at the control, at the operating modes to control the LEDs once more. When you buy an LED, you must follow the manufacturer's instructions. Try to use the mode the manufacturer recommends. We have only these two types, leading and trailing edge. What is the difference between leading and trailing edge? Leading edge LEDs are dimmable smoother, but on the other hand, they may have less dynamic. Trailing edge, however, there is less power loss, and it means a higher load can be connected to an output. So we should always try to go for trailing edge. Always try to get lamps for trailing edge control, because here you can have the higher output load on the dimmer. Another advice, may I call it a good advice or just an advice? Never mix different types and wattages on one channel of a dimmer. And this is a global advice. You should use it for every dimmer, of course. Okay, let's have a look at maximum and minimum output loads of such a dimmer. The maximum output load depends on the load type. We have seen the load types already, and we are concentrating, of course, on the LEDs. It, however, also depends on the type of dimming. As I said, use trailing edge dimming, which always gives a higher output load. For example, here we have an example of a Philips lamp. We have tested on the leading edge mode. It had an inrush current of 1 amp. It's only a 13 watt lamp. Look at this. And a trailing edge is only 0.25 amps. So actually you can use 4 times more lamps in trailing edge mode than in leading edge mode. Now the question is, can I set it up? Can I set up the dimmer so that also in trailing edge mode, it has a smooth dimming behavior? Another issue is always the minimum load, as I have mentioned. A universal dimmer nowadays should be designed to support even the smallest loads being known on the market. Now, here we have a table which shows a comparison of load types and their maximum output. Let me concentrate on dimmable LEDs. And what you can see here, we have a comparison, we have a ratio which is much better than that of legacy dimmers. We have a maximum of 66% ratio versus the operation of incandescent lamps. Incandescent lamps will always be better than LED or any other type of lamps on a dimmer. So the target was, when we developed this device, have here a maximum value, have a value which is as big as possible. And even if we bundle the channels, we are not far below this maximum of 66%, as you can see here. And again, no minimum load is required. Dimming quality of LEDs. Once more, minimum and maximum brightness have to be set up on the dimmers. As you have seen this curve before, the curve starts perhaps at 20 or 30% dimming value and ends already maybe at 90% or even at 80%. I have had such tests, and the ratio between minimum and maximum dimming value was far below 100%. But with a flexible dimmer curve, dimming curve, you can adjust this so that actually the 1% dimming value is internally like if I send 35% to the dimmer. The switch on behavior sometimes is also a problem, because if the dimmer switches on only at 30%, what happens below? If you send all values between 1 and 29% to the dimmer, should it turn on to 30% or should it stay off? You have parameters, you should have parameters to be able to set this. Switching on via dimming, this is also something. The normal parameter switching on via dimming is switch on, yes, don't switch off, because you want to use the minimum brightness also. But in some cases, you might change this parameter. Okay, let me show you the perfect solution now. You have seen all the features it must have, and I can promise you this device has all these features. All the features at a glance on one page. This device is a 4-channel dimmer for 230 volt. It can operate LEDs and also other lamps, of course, of all kind of loads, capacitive, inductive as well. Minimum load is practically none. It's below 1 watt. Each output has 300 watt amps, watts. Of course, this is for incandescent lamps, but we have seen for LEDs, it's also 200. And by channel bundling, all this device, all 4 channels can be linked together and will provide 1000 volt ampere. We have the direct operation at the front panel, and we have the comprehensive controls, override, and diagnostic functions as mentioned before. By the way, the mechanics of the device is also very interesting. Maintenance-free terminals, which can take up to 2.5 millimeters of cross-section, untreated single-core stranded or multi-core conductors. Okay, the power supply is all from the bus. So you can operate this device. Of course, you must apply 230 volts for the dimmer. This is logic. But beside this, only the bus connection is necessary to program this device. So it's a perfectly suitable for dimming high power LEDs and other lamp types. Just very quickly, the mechanical features once more, especially the maintenance-free terminals, what I wanted to explain here. And together with the double terminals that we have for each connection, so no matter if it is neutral, if it is the outer conductor, or if it is the dimmer output, they are all double available, which means additional external terminal blocks can be omitted. So the summary is the new Siemens Universal Dimmer switches and dims all lights, lamps, especially LEDs, up to a maximum output of 300 watts per channel. You can bundle it to 1000 watts, enables the optimum dimming behavior by the flexible curves, is reliable in operation, and supports efficient planning. So if you want to have more information, then you go to siemens.com/gamma-td, and here you enter 5WG1554, hit return or search, and you will get all the present available information. What we have under preparation is an e-learning as well. So always very, very short videos for the usage of this dimmer. So they will be published in the next few weeks, and you can return to our Siemens website to get all this information. Okay, so let me go to the questions now. Let me see what I have to answer. Is there any questions? Yeah, will we receive a handout of the presentation by mail? I think KNX Association will provide this. I see from Mr. Martin Tremblay, does the channel output send DC voltage to the LED lamp? No, it does not. It is working like a normal dimmer in trailing or in leading edge operation mode. Okay, I think all the questions are covered. It is already on the market, as I can see. What does the question mean? Do you keep the provided LED driver? No. We have designed a device which can cope with all LED drivers, no matter what they do. So we don't need to have the knowledge of the LED drivers anymore. That's the big advantage of this dimmer now. All right, so I will give the controls back to the KNX Association. Thank you very much once more for listening. And okay.
Thank you very much, Mr. Grossman, for the informative presentation. As I can see, that most of the questions have been answered. And there are still some questions that remain unanswered from the KNX side. Now I'll give the floor to my colleague Chris again to answer these questions regarding the ETS demo.
First of all, just give me a minute, please, to go through the chat again, just briefly, and then just to make sure that I didn't miss anything. So I just scroll again. I saw here in the very beginning, there was indeed a question about where can I get this KNX demo? Maybe I answered that first. Well, our intention is to extend our eCampus platform. Maybe you have heard of it. So we offer an eCampus platform to which you can, for which you can register. It's a, you can get yourself a free account there. And in the future, in the near future, we're going to extend it with this software. So amongst others, you will see what I have illustrated to you. So that is the first question. So yes, you can get it, but you just need to be a little bit patient though. So still scrolling through the questions, I see then probably a bunch of questions that were actually for Axel, I think.
Right.
He probably already answered them.
No, not all of them.
No, maybe not all of them. Wait a moment. Then at the very end, I see something here about KNX Secure. Okay, that is for me.
It does not support KNX Secure, Data Secure.
Ah, okay.
We are not intending to do this at the moment because our target is we want to provide IP Secure in the future. And we think internally, if we have IP Secure, Data Secure is not necessary.
Okay, I think that is an answer to that question. And then I see, another one comes now. Is that for you, Axel?
I have two more. Kurt Vermeulen, any plans for bigger than four? That means, I think, he asks if we planning to build bigger dimmers. Mm-hmm. No, we don't. This is 8 space units already, which means if we would extend it to 6 or 8 channels, we would extend the space required in the distribution board, where it's only 12 space units usually. And the next question was by Mr. Helmut Zimmermann. Will color temperature be maintained during dimming? Well, this is just a matter of the lamp itself. We can dim all the lamps, and if the lamp provides a constant color temperature while being dimmed, then it's fine, but we cannot control this.
Okay, and the last one, Axel, is this also for you, the UL slash ULC?
Oh, okay, this just came in.
Yeah, indeed.
Yes, we have plans. We have plans, but I cannot give you my secrets at the moment because it's not yet finished, but we have plans.
Okay. Then I guess that the still valid is about the feedback object. So I will just indeed shortly demonstrate that, because that is how I understood it. And I just need to show ETS. So where was I? Yes, the feedback. So let me just select those channels again. So indeed, there's here in the push button a feedback in order to indeed indicate whether the lamp is switched on or not. And I get this information from the dimmer indeed, so via the info on off object. So basically the only thing that I have to do is to link them, because indeed currently right now this is not working. We have no feedback. The buttons just remain black, so to say, but I can change that behavior. So let me try that. So I select both objects. So the info on off from the dimmer and the push button feedback object. So what I'll just need to do is to link them again with a group address. Yes, the 014 info on off. Okay. Fine. Then I just program the devices again. So both of them, of course. Just a partial download. And here for the push button, the same thing. Let me clear the monitor again. And then we should have this feedback. So if I switch on now this lamp, I indeed get this feedback. So you have see the difference now. The lamps definitely switched on because of the red color here. I can switch it back off, and then it's switched off. Of course, if I dim it down, it's maybe not 100%, but the lamp is, of course, still switched on. So therefore, it remains red, also with a value, let's say, higher than zero.